stand this morning and sing with us? Let's sing, who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves his breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. Unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, and I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan the son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun, all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Continue to sing.
So bless the Lord, oh my soul, and oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, and oh my soul, I worship your holy name.
This morning. Well, so glad to see you all here today. And my name is Pastor Steve. I have the privilege of being one of the pastors here on staff. You know, it's great through the month of July, we actually have our children in here with us on purpose. It kind of serves a couple of different roles. One, it gives our leaders and our Sunday school teachers an opportunity to just kind of step back and regroup and refresh and be ready to go for the fall. But also, too, it gives us that consistency for our children to see what does worship look like? What does offering look like? What does it look like for mom and dad to pray? And actually, I'm going to talk about that a little bit later in the service. But the reason I'm bringing that up is because my pew is shrinking. I've been sitting up here, my wife and I, for about 7.5 years. And when we first got here, Parker was 3 and Peyton was 5. And so now Parker is 10 and Peyton is 13. So my pew is getting smaller. I need a lot of space to worship. So, but it's great having our kids in with us for the month of July. And I just have a couple quick things I want to share with you this morning. Our prayers on location are going extremely well. It has been a phenomenal opportunity to see how God is working and moving. And the reports that we received this past week when we were in Batavia were phenomenal. In fact, the time was too short. The reports that people, when they came back, of how the Holy Spirit was leading them and guiding them into conversation, and that was just the different people that we also met with. The unlikely people are the ones that sometimes have the most information. So for me, my prayer, as I told you 2 weeks ago, was, God, just lead me to a person that can share more information about the needs of the city. And God answered that prayer. Well, this past Wednesday, my prayer was the same. I said, God, lead me to somebody who can share more about the needs or about what's happening in the life of the city. Well, he led me to a 94-year-old lady named Lori. is probably the oldest Lori that I know. And 94 years old, Parker and I sat down with her next to a park bench, and she began to share with me information and statistics about the city of Batavia that I was unaware of, and the future growth and how the city is aligning itself towards growth. And I mean, again, completely unlikely that you would meet a 94-year-old woman who would have so much information. She had lived in the city or is living in the city for over 40 years, just has a real heart for that area. And so just a really neat opportunity. I asked her, hey, can we pray for you? How can we pray? And she said, you know, my walking isn't very good. She's like, I can get around and I can do a lot of things, but my walking is pretty rough. And as Parker and I were with her that and hearing that, Parker prayed over her and prayed for her walking. So it was really, really cool. It was really awesome. Just a great opportunity. So I'm saying all that to encourage you that it looks different for everyone. But each person, as they're coming to these prayer on locations, they're hearing and they're sensing and they're seeing where is God moving and how is he moving. So this next one for us is going to be in North Aurora. So North Aurora is a city that's right in between Aurora and Batavia. And we're going to meet at Harner's Restaurant. Now, I can tell you that if there was, in all the locations that we're going to be, if you want baked goods, this is the week to come. Harner's Restaurant is known for their quality baked goods and their kind of home-cooked food, and so we're going to be meeting there. That's completely optional at 6 o'clock, and then at 7 o'clock, we're going to meet right there at the restaurant as well. Again, each week, we do the same thing. We talk about going out. Everybody does something different. Some people go out alone. Some people go out in groups. Some people engage in conversation with others, and others just walk and pray. Some people go out and all they do is just walk around and observe and just take in, you know, what does this city look like? So it's meant for everybody to come and to have an opportunity to engage at whatever level you're most comfortable. So North Aurora is this week. We're going to meet at Harner's, and then we'll go out and then come back. So I want to encourage you to do that. Last thing I want to share with you, exciting things are happening in our partnership with the Hope Church, our Indian church that meets in the refuge. And today at 1 o'clock, they are going to have a baptismal service here in the sanctuary. I'm excited to share that with you because I know that for many of us, we love baptism. We celebrate baptism. When we have our own baptisms, it's exciting. And I don't know what your plans are and if you have time, but at 1 o'clock today, if you want to come back and support the Hope Church and participate in baptism service with them, I know that they would just be thrilled. So we've got the cover off. The water's in, and it's, you know, it's great. So if anybody this morning is feeling called for baptism, just raise your hand. I'll go put my trunks on, and let's go. Come on. We've got water. Actually, I don't even need to put, I'll get in like this. I'll take the mic off first. So that's happening at 1 o'clock today, and let's make sure that we really continually support the Hope Church in prayer as they are reaching out. August 11th is the India Day Parade here in the city of Naperville. It's the largest Indian gathering and parade in the nation that occurs, and it's here in Naperville. Over 30,000 people will come. And so we, the Hope Church, is actually offering and extending an opportunity for us to partner with them and to engage in a community that that we would otherwise not necessarily have an inroad to engage with. So really great things, exciting things happening in the life of the church. As we move into our time of receiving his tithes and our offerings, let's pray together. Gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you for your presence. Lord, I don't want to miss the opportunity to praise you for what you did last week in this place. Lord, it is not out of the realm of possibility, nor should it be shocking or surprising to us to potentially experience the moving of your Holy Spirit like we did last week. Lord, we are craving more of your presence. We know that there are situations in our life that occur or have taken place that our desire level just increases, sometimes out of excitement and other times out of desperation. So Lord, I pray that you would continually push out the things that want to distract us from being in relationship with you. Lord, I pray for our kiddos this morning, our little worshipers this morning, and that as they are experiencing summer and then now their mind begins to think about going back to school, Lord, I pray that you would be meeting with them, helping them to be able to navigate these potential new waters. Lord, as a church, we are blessed and thankful to be able to go and to put our feet to action. Not just talk about praying into spaces and into cities, but actually physically going and walking in those areas. Lord, I'm reminded even what I heard on Wednesday, that this opportunity, it's a two-way opportunity. It's not just our opportunity to pray to God and pray for a city, but it's also God's opportunity to pray into us. So Lord, we want to open those gates wide. We want to open those doors wide to experience your presence. And Lord, as we continue through this service, may you receive the glory. May you receive the honor and the praise. And as we continue in worship through the receiving of your tithes and our offerings, Lord, may our hands be open to not only receive, but also to give to you today. We thank you. We give you honor, praise, and thanks for these things. And it's your name we pray. Amen.
Oh,
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Hearts will cry, these bones will say, great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath
I'm going to ask you just to remain standing just for a few minutes. Every so often in the life of the church, we have to say goodbye to people, and unfortunately in this area it's all too common. And the one thing that we've done as a church is we've embraced the opportunity not to say goodbye, but instead to send. You know, this series, this Sent series, is intentional. It's important for us living out these sent lives. But when people are transitioning or when they're moving, we want to instill in them that they are not leaving, they're being sent. And this morning, we're going to be saying goodbye to, or we're sending, two incredible couples, the Sloanes and the Budatimas. And I'm going to ask them to come forward if they would be so inclined. And I'm going to ask them just to come and to just come over here to this side of the altar and just to kneel. And as they come, I'd like for us as the church, and if you feel comfortable or if you have a relationship with them, I want to invite you and extend the opportunity for you to come and just to lay hands on them. You know, throughout Scripture, so go ahead and come on. Throughout Scripture, the laying on of hands is intentional. The opportunity to bestow a blessing upon people is something that we see often in Scripture. And these two couples are incredibly important and vital couples to our church. Jan and Paul Sloan, they started to attend Trinity when it wasn't even in this building. Their first Sunday with a little girl in tow was over in Warrenville, and that little girl became our youth pastor. And so they've been here for over 30 years in the life of the church. Both of them have had incredible impacts, not just on the church in itself, but also on the spiritual lives of those around us. Tina and Irwin came to the church as well a long time ago, and they brought with them who we affectionately know as Booty. And Booty's been living in California, and it's time for mom and dad to be closer to him. One of the amazing things is what you would not see them do publicly, you would hear that they do privately. Tina and Irwin, they live in the background on purpose. They serve without ever wanting any recognition, without anybody ever knowing it. And on the Sunday that we lost our couple that made coffee, the next Sunday, here comes Tina and Irwin. They don't even drink coffee. But they came faithfully every Sunday morning to make coffee for those of us who can't survive without it. But all joking aside, these are moments and these are opportunities in the life of the church for us to pray a blessing and to say thank you, and also that God would bless them as they go. So as we pray this morning, I would encourage you just to join me in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, this morning we come before you and we're thankful and we're reminded of how often you move in power in our lives, how often that we see your hand move in ways that we can't even ask or imagine. And through these two couples, the Sloanes and the Budatimas, Lord, we have been blessed. Blessed by the journey that they've taken with us as a church. Blessed by their care, much even differently, and their love for the advancement of your kingdom. Lord, we thank you for the hours of ministry that they poured into this place. For the early mornings, the sleepless nights, and the opportunities to build relationships that will last forever. And Lord, we're thankful that on that day, we pray that in reunited together one day in heaven, that there will be even many who will show up and say, thank you for your ministry. I am changed and I am here because of your ministry and because of the grace of God. So, Lord, I pray over the Sloanes this morning. I pray over their ministry in Lafayette. I pray over the family that they'll impact. I pray for the next steps in their story. Lord, we know that they're excited because they know that this is not even the closing of one chapter, it's really the opening of another. And they're excited to find out what you have for them. So Lord, I pray over them right now, and I pray a blessing that you would reach deep into them to know that they are being faithful to follow you wherever you lead. Lord, I pray for their neighbors. Lord, I pray that they would have an incredible opportunity to share your love with their neighbors and the people that they come in contact with around them. So I thank you for the Sloans. Thank you for their obedience. And Lord, we send them and we pray that blessing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit this morning. Lord, I lift up Tina and Irwin to you. Lord, how much I will miss their faithfulness, their loving hearts. There's warm smiles every time you look at them, and especially the power of their prayers, knowing that they faithfully not only pray for us and pray for the church, but they also pray for the martyred church around the world. Lord, you placed a burden on their heart to pray for the martyrs that are losing their life but gaining the kingdom for your name. And so, Lord, I pray over them as they transition. I pray over all that they are going to be able to accomplish and to experience. Lord, for both the Sloans and the Buddha team, as I pray for a wonderful church. Lord, I pray that their blessing doesn't end here, but they would be able to bless a new community, and that you would continue to grow them in incredible ways. So, Lord, I pray this blessing over the Buddha Timas in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Lord, these might be moments and times where we are sending, but there are also times and opportunities for the congregation to step into. We know that both the Sloans and the Buddha Timas leave behind ministries and leave behind places where they've served faithfully. And, Lord, I pray that you would be raising up leaders within the church right now that would step in and fill those spaces. So it's opportunities, Lord, that you've laid before us today. And Lord, as a church, we desire to be a church that prays for other churches. And so this morning, we pray for the Naperville Korean United Methodist Church. Lord, I pray for your powerful spirit, just as it's experiencing it now here in this place, but that it would be experienced there right now as well. So, Lord, we lift up the Naperville Korean United Methodist Church. And, Lord, knowing that we are a group of Nazarene churches in our area called the Chicago Central District, Lord, we lift up to you Giving Hope Church in Moments. And we lift up to you Pastor Jennifer Jensen, that you would be moving in power through their service. And Lord, we know that they made a historic move as a church because they wanted to be more relevant in the kingdom. They wanted to meet more needs in their community. So Lord, we pray for them this morning that you would move in power. And Lord, we pray for our missionaries around the world, and especially David and Rhonda Ackerman that are serving in the Philippines on the Micronesia field. Lord, even though it's probably nighttime there, we pray that you would be just speaking over them, Lord, that their ministry would be filled, that you would be giving them in life, that whatever it is that they're experiencing, Lord, that you would show them this path forward. Lord, I thank you for what you're doing and our missionaries around the world. Lord, I pray for Sam this morning, Sam Kwok. I pray for the team that he's leading to South Korea. And we pray for them this morning that they would have an incredible, fruitful time in South Korea, advancing your kingdom through that trip. And so again, Lord, we're thankful for these moments and these opportunities. Yes, we're sad, but we're also excited to see what you'll do. And so now, Lord, as we move through the rest of this service, we pray for your hand to be upon us. And again, I just pray and lift these couples up to you, and we pray this in your name. Amen. Amen. several years ago in 2013 in Papua New Guinea. There was a lot of civil unrest in this small country. There was a lot of killings that were happening. A lot of Christians were being actually martyred in Papua New Guinea. And during this time, the West Highlands District of the Church of the Nazarene was meeting for their district assembly. The Aukus family was the district superintendents that oversaw that district, and they were inviting the general superintendents to come in. And days before, the general superintendent actually came in to help officiate over the district assembly. That area was rocked. It was rocked by men, the militant men that were going around, and they were trying to take the lives of believers. And all of a sudden, in the middle of the night, the Aukus family were moved for their safety because they did get received word that there was going to be men that were going to try to come and harm their husband, who was the district superintendent. So as they were being held in a separate area, the daughters of the district superintendents were with someone else for their safety as well. Well, in the middle of the night, five men drove onto the property in an unmarked vehicle. Later, they found that this vehicle was actually rented. These men got out of this vehicle wearing masks, carrying machetes, and AK-47 assault rifles. They were specifically looking for the district superintendent. Well, at the same time, simultaneously, the district superintendent's wife was making her way across the campground or across the campus in order to find her daughter. She just wanted to check on them. These five men found the district superintendent's wife, and they grabbed her, and they held her captive in the middle of this compound. They kept asking her over and over again, "Where is your husband? Where is your husband?" And she refused to tell him. Multiple times they asked her, and she refused to say anything. In one fell swoop, one of the men was holding a machete, sliced it across her wrist. And then all of a sudden they said, "Tell us where your husband is," and she refused. She just kept saying, "Jesus, save me. Jesus, save me. Jesus, save me." Every time they asked her a question, she would say, "Jesus, save me." Well, these men were getting more irate. They were getting more upset, and they took out the AK-47 rifle, and they put it up to the chin, up to her chin underneath. And all of a sudden, in that moment, there was a shot that rang out, and his wife's body lays on the ground. The men jumped back into their vehicles, and they sped off. And all of a sudden, everybody within in the distance, I could hear in the compound, everybody awoke and they ran out to that area expecting the worst. And all of a sudden, the DS's wife stood up just weeping, understanding that Jesus had just saved her. 2 days later, the general superintendent, J.K. Warwick, came to that district assembly and he met with the district superintendent and his wife. She showed him the wrist, her wrist, that with the force and the sharpness of the blade should have actually cut her hand off. It was literally just a bruise. The area underneath her chin had a red welt from the force of the muzzle of the rifle. But nothing ever came out of the gun. It fired. It woke everybody up. But she was saved. The amazing thing is the story doesn't end there. A few months after this incident actually occurred, General J.K. Warwick was at Danville First Church on our district for our district assembly. He shared the very same story that I just shared with you. Afterwards, an elder couple, a retired pastor in the Church of Nazarene, came up to him with tears in his eyes, and he says, "Now I know. Now I know." And Dr. Warwick looked at him, he says, "Now you know what?" He says, "Now I know why the Holy Spirit led me to pray that the AK-47 rifles that were used to persecute Christians would plug with mud and they wouldn't fire." And Norma, his wife that was standing next to him, said, "He's telling the truth. We prayed for months, every morning, that specifically AK-47 assault rifles would plug with mud and they would not be able to fire or kill Christians. They did this faithfully for months. The power of prayer. The power of prayer. Here's the thing, Norma and George Wood. Some of you may even know Norma and George. They attend College Church, University Campus, or University Boulevard in Bourbonnais. They followed the obedient direction of the Holy Spirit to pray specifically for this to happen. And little did they know that around the world, months later, their prayer would be answered. Now, here's the amazing thing. That story made it back to them. But I wonder how often we're called by the Holy Spirit to pray specifically, but the story never gets back to us. And I wonder if that changes our obedient level. If it changes anything about the power in which we're called to pray. Because even if we don't know why God says to pray this way, should it change the intensity by which we pray? It shouldn't. I mean, they're blessed to be able to hear this story. And then the reason I know this story is because I was sitting in a huge room in Indianapolis for General Assembly. And Dr. Warwick got up and he told the story. And he had the couple, the AUKUS couple, stand up, the district superintendents of that district in Papua New Guinea. And everybody clapped and cheered. And he said, but the story doesn't end there. And then he had George and Norma Wood stand up. And the two of them met in that large convention center. And I'll tell you what, the place came unglued because of the faithfulness, the obedience, and the call to prayer. We've been in this series through the book of Acts, and I have to tell you, at the infancy stage of the early church, the one thing that was foundational and concrete to their success and to their moving forward as a church was prayer. That's all they had. There were times in the life of the church where all they had was prayer. Trying to figure out what direction were they going to go, they prayed. Trying to figure out how they were going to heal somebody or if somebody was going to get healed, they prayed. To figure out what next steps that they were going to take, they prayed. I mean, all along the way, they stopped and they prayed. Prayer, as you can see, was something that they gave their lives to. Acts 1:8 uses that word devoted. We talked about that a few weeks ago. What does it mean to be devoted? They were devoted to prayer. You know, one of the best tools for teaching prayer in the early church was to simply pray together. Now, you have to remember, this early church, they didn't have any idea of how to pray. I mean, they had different mechanisms and different things, and they knew different prayers. But do you remember even the disciples themselves, they looked at Jesus and they said, teach us to pray. And the reason why the disciples asked Jesus to teach them to pray was because John the Baptist's disciples were praying, and I guess it sounded really good because they were like, we want to pray like that. Now think about that. Because John the Baptist taught his disciples how to pray, and because of their public prayer, praying together, Jesus' disciples hear that, they turn to their rabbi and they say, teach us to pray. And then Jesus turns around and he teaches them to pray, and what we know as the Lord's Prayer. You see, one of the greatest things that assets that we have is each other. I keep saying this each week. And I want us to know, I get it, like this is messy. Whenever you put more than one person in a room, it gets messy. Actually, sometimes we don't even need another person. It's just messy. But we have each other and we lean on God, but we also lean on one another. And we can learn from one another. And a tool of prayer, like I even mentioned it this morning, about having our children to see us pray. To know what that sounds like. You know, the coolest thing is if we always kept our children out of the service, they never would have experienced what the Holy Spirit did last week. But you know, our kids have questions. They want to know, what was that about? What happened? Why didn't you preach? right? Like, why, that's a question. Why didn't you preach? And well, because that was the message. So chances are most of what you've learned about prayer or even how to pray was learned from hearing others. Many of you, you were blessed to maybe have parents in your home that prayed and you listened to them pray and it taught you how to pray. Many of you, maybe you didn't have parents in the home that prayed, but you had somebody in your life that when they prayed, you knew that there was something different happening. And you learned from them in those moments. And I'll be honest with you, even as a pastor, some of the ways and the things that I pray was because my mentor pastor prayed that way. I can almost hear him sometimes in me when I'm praying. I can hear him saying prayers. It's amazing how that works. But it's because we listen and we hear. So I'm going to give you some context. I want you to turn with me to Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4 is where we're at. Now, if you're using the red Bibles in front of you, it's going to be on page 984. And the yellow Bibles, it's going to be on page 833. Now, let me make you aware, because we do this every time. It's really amazing. I love it. Those Bibles in the pew in front of you are gifts. They're gifts for you to take. If you need a Bible, if you know somebody who needs a Bible, take them with you, because we love to see God's word go from this place. So in Acts chapter 4, let me give you a little bit of context before we jump in, because we're actually going to jump in more towards the end. 6 weeks, that's all the time frame that we're looking at between Jesus' death and resurrection. 6 weeks is this story found in Acts chapter 4. So in Acts chapter 4, we find Peter and John standing in front of the same exact group of people that just tried and convicted and executed Jesus on the cross. Now, Peter and John are standing in front of them. And this group of people are blown away by the fact that these mere mortals, right, these ordinary men, Peter and John, just healed a guy that had been lame and paralyzed for 40 years, over 40 years. So they can't deny that this man is healed because he's standing right in front of them, and they're a little bit afraid of what the crowd might do, so they pull Peter and John aside, and they're like, hey, do us a favor. You can't keep talking about this man named Jesus, and you especially can't keep telling people that we were the ones that killed him, right? And they're trying to shut down the propaganda machine. They actually literally called, if you break down the word that they use is propaganda. Stop falsifying or using this propaganda. So now all of a sudden we pick up the story in verse 24 in Acts 4. Peter and John go back to the group. They go back to the church and they report out what just happened. And then this is the response of the church. When they heard the report, all the believers lifted their voices together in prayer to God. O sovereign Lord, creator of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. We're going to stop right there. So the report was Peter and John going back to the church and them saying, hey, listen, you know the Sanhedrin? You remember the guys that just killed Jesus? Yeah, they don't want us to share anymore about Jesus. So immediately the whole entire church goes, oh, that's a good idea. We shouldn't do that anymore. We don't want to ruffle any feathers. We don't want to make anybody upset. No, that is not what they did. That's not what they did. They did not shrink back and go, oh, you're right, we probably should be more cautious. We should probably be more careful. No, instead, they prayed with greater boldness. They prayed with greater confidence. They prayed for God to do what only God can do. And there's really three essential things I want to point out to you about this corporate prayer. See, one of the things that we talk about in the life of the church is prayer. And we talk about individual prayer and the prayer that we do maybe on our own. But there's also an aspect of the church that calls us to corporate prayer, to pray together. And I'm going to give us three quick things about what that looks like. So the first thing, and if we read this verse 24, quickly, we're going to miss the elements of what happened in this moment. So we're going to break this down. The first thing that they did was they lifted their voices. So in verse 24, it says, they lifted their voices together in prayer to God. So one of the first things they did was they lifted their voices. There's power in praying out loud together. Now, granted, I know that many of you, you just went, nope, no way, praying out loud for another person to hear me? I get it. But I want to tell you that I want to encourage you, and I get that not everybody feels comfortable to do that. Not everybody feels maybe even borderline, I'd say, called or felt like they should do that. But I want to encourage you that if you surround yourself with gracious people, that is a prayer exercise that can help take your prayer life to even another level. But that's what they did. They prayed out loud. Has anybody ever been in a concert of prayer? Just raise your hand if you've ever been in a concert of prayer. Like, raise them a little bit higher, because I see some hands. Okay, good. Yeah, there's many people that have been in a concert of prayer. If you've ever heard that word, you know it means something different. A concert of prayer is literally everyone praying at the same time, out loud, together. And it sounds loud, depending on where you are. And it sounds sometimes even raucous. You've heard me say before that prayer is the engine of the church. I tell people all the time, listen, you can have a really nice, shiny car, and it can sit out in your driveway. But if that car doesn't have an engine, it's not going anywhere. It's just a shiny piece of metal. But when you add, if we look at that in the life of the church, there are many churches that are really nice, and they're really shiny, and they sit out in the driveway, and they look really great. The problem is there's no engine inside. No prayer, no engine. So maybe the challenge is to think about it is, what does the engine sound like of our spiritual car? Think about that on two levels. The individual level, what does the engine sound like of your own personal spiritual car? And maybe what does the engine sound like in the life of corporately, in the life of the church? I mean, like, I kind of thought about it this way. You know, have you ever heard the engine of a Maserati? It just sounds good, right? You could put a Maserati engine in a Volkswagen Bug, and that Volkswagen Bug becomes the coolest sounding Volkswagen ever, right? Because it just sounds good. You know, I mean, 12, what are those called? V8?
Cylinders.
Thank you, 12 cylinders. I mean, it just sounds good, right? And then have you ever heard the engine of a gremlin? Yeah, many of you are like, I don't know if I should laugh right now, right? It doesn't sound the same. And I know that I'm not comparing and saying that, you know, if the spiritual engine sounds like a Maserati, it's going to be better than a gremlin, because the reality is sometimes churches don't even have engines. And we've negated the number one way for the Holy Spirit to speak into a community by alleviating and turning off the radio that God wants to use to communicate his message to us. I mean, that's basically the equivalent of what happens. And I'll tell you, I never, ever want to be in a church or be a part of a church or even lead a church that isn't going to turn on the radio so that we can hear from God and we can know where he's leading us. And we do that through prayer, individually and corporately. So prayer is important. It's important to us. So they lifted up their voices. The second thing they did was they lifted their voices, now this is a key word, together. So lifting up your voice is one principle, but doing it together is another principle in itself. They found unity, and this incredible Greek word that Luke uses is actually hama thematin. Am I saying that right? It's going to be up on the screen here in a second, I promise. It's the Greek word. Yes, there it is. Yeah. Hama thematin. One accord. It means together. It's literally 10 times it's used in Acts, and only 12 times it's used in Scripture. And 10 times it's found here in the book of Acts. It literally means in one accord. Now, because I'm talking about cars, many are going, they were all in one accord? Like, that seems small. Not that accord. Meaning together. In fact, if you break this word even further, if you break it down even further, it's actually two words combined into one: to rush along and in unison. To rush along and in unison. It's actually a reference to music. It's a musical reference because even though there are times where each note is being played separately, when you put them together, it makes a sound that puts it all together into this beautiful music. It's the dissonance. It's the chords. It's the harmony. It's all of those things. Each individual note played by itself is just going to sound like a note, but when it's all played together, it creates a symphony. That's what this word means. That's how they prayed. It was together. Here's an example of this is actually can be found, so my family and I, we love to go camping. And one of the things that we do when we're done with our campfire is we either put water on it or we separate the wood. Because when you separate the wood, the fire isn't as hot. Any of your dashboard lights going off? You see, when the church comes together and prays together, you're putting your individual wood together with the rest of the wood around you, and it becomes a flame, and it becomes powerful, and it becomes hotter. But as soon as you separate that wood out, what happens to the wood? It begins to become less. It begins to fade out. It's not as on fire. And that's a good lesson, even just when it comes to being in attendance. Right? When the wood's together, the fire's hotter. When the wood's separate, the fire goes out. So when we talk about even in the life of prayer, Matthew 18, Jesus says, I tell you the truth, wherever two or three are gathered in agreement in my name, there I will be also. Multiple times through Scripture, there's a difference, and even in Deuteronomy, it talks about that one can flee 1,000, but two can flee 10,000, or set them to flight, I think is the actual word. In Deuteronomy. So all throughout Scripture, we see the difference between one person versus two people. And Jesus even says, if two or three are gathered in my name in agreement, that word agreement is so important because I hear people all the time go, well, just two or three are gathered together. Listen, you can put two or three people together in a room. If they're not praying together, it's not going to all go together. It's an agreement. If it's understanding why are we gathered, who are we praying to, and why are we praying, when you put those things together, that's where the power comes. That's where the power comes. Third thing they did was they prayed to God. I know, you're like, whoo, right? But it's true, and we have to stop here. Because the word Lord in Scripture here particularly is really interesting. Just like the Greek word to talk about the harmony of together in one accord, Luke uses a very specific Greek word to talk about, O sovereign Lord. It's actually despotes. It's the Greek word despotes, and it means Lord or master, but let's take it a step further. It's used only 10 times in the entire Bible. It's only used 10 times in the entire Bible. And it's to understand the relationship of a slave to a slave owner or the power that a master has and that it's unquestionable power. That's ultimately what it means, unquestionable power. It's a power you don't doubt. It's a power you don't question. It's a power you understand that what Luke is saying here is when the early church prayed, they prayed to a God that had unquestionable power. Now, what do you think that did to their prayer life? When you begin to pray to a God that has unquestionable power, when you understand that he is master, that he is Lord, and we are his servants, what do you think that does to that prayer power with them? What type of confidence do you think that brings out? What type of power happens to them in their prayer? Praying with power because they knew God had unquestionable power. So I'll give you a little illustration. I had a best friend growing up named Brian. Brian was big and tough. If you wanted to have a best friend, you wanted them to be big and tough. And so Brian was both. And there were times that when Brian was around, all of a sudden I got a little bit more lippy with the people around me. I got a little bit more jumpy, felt a little more froggy, if you will. Because all Brian had to do was literally look, and he would look at people and give them this look, and they'd be like, oh. Or he would just stand up. I mean, there were times that Brian just stood up, and his presence alone was like, yeah, what you got? What you got, right? And then all of a sudden, like, people would yell back, you know, hey, wait till Brian's gone. Okay. I was a skinny little kid. My mouth got me into trouble and got me out of trouble. It's a two-way street. So, but it's the same thing when we think about prayer. When you know that you have the backing of an unbelievably powerful, unquestionable power God, it changes the way that you pray. You might look at the issues in your life. You may look at the things that are going on, and you might even look at the things that are trying to distract you, and you might get a little bit more lippy with them because you got a God that's got your back. Because God, all he has to do is give a look. All he has to do sometimes is stand up. You ever seen the movie The Bear? I love it. It's the best scene in the whole movie. Little bear cub gets separated, and he gets adopted by this big old grizzly bear, and this grizzly bear takes him around and shows him the ways. It's like completely uncommon. Completely uncommon. And all of a sudden, this jaguar comes down out of the mountain and sees this bear cub, and he's trying to learn how to fish on the water, and this jaguar comes down, and rawr, rawr, and he's yelling at him and scraping at him, and this bear cub, all of a sudden, he does what he's learned from his big buddy, you know, the grizzly bear, and he stands up, and he lets out this, right? I mean, he's a little bear cub. He's going to have it, you know, and all of a sudden, you look at the jaguar, and the jaguar's like, what? You know, and he's like all freaking out. The jaguar starts backing up, and the bear cub's like, you know, and he keeps getting closer, and he's like, wow, this is really working. Pan back. You know who's standing behind him. That big old grizzly bear, 8 foot tall or 7 foot tall, stands up, lets out this huge roar, and that mountain lion is gone. And the cub, you know, comes down off of his two paws, and he turns around, he's like, that's right. You know? But that's the way it is when we pray. Man, if we pray little prayers, we're going to get little results. If you pray big prayers, you're going to get big results. And sometimes I know there's many of us, we're doing the brain-mind game, and we're going, but I've prayed big prayers, and I haven't seen God come through. That's because it's not in your time, it's in His. Are you willing to pray for months for AK-47s to be plugged with mud and to help save martyrs from being, Christians from being killed in another country? Are you willing to pray that prayer for months, not knowing if that story will ever come back to you? Are you willing to listen intently to the Holy Spirit and just be quiet enough to say, God, what would you have me pray for? And then to diligently pray for that. Are you willing to do that? Because that's what the early church was willing to do. And I want you to listen to their prayer, because they began to pray like a little bear cub, knowing that the grizzly was standing behind him. Listen to this, verse 29. And now, O Lord, hear their threats. Hear their threats. Give us, your servants, great boldness in preaching your word. They didn't back down. The Sanhedrin's going, hey, guys, let's keep it down. Let's keep it down. Let's stop at the propaganda. We're not going to talk about Jesus anymore. Especially stop talking about how we killed them. It wasn't our fault. And they said, no. They said, give us great boldness in preaching your word. Stretch out your hand with healing power. May miraculous signs and wonders be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. That's how they prayed. They prayed with confidence. They prayed with power. They prayed with boldness. We have the same opportunity, church. We are not going to cower in fear. We are not going to look around and go, oh, okay. We're going to pray with confidence and power and boldness because we have a God who is confident, powerful, and bold. After this prayer, the meeting place shook, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Then they preached the word of God with boldness. You see, their prayers led them to action. Their prayers led them to action. They did something about it. They said, hear their threats. Give us boldness. We want miraculous healing. And then they preached. What do your prayers lead you to? What do your prayers lead you to? Does it lead you to action? Yeah, think about this. When was the last time you prayed with confidence? When was the last time you prayed with power or boldness? I want us to think about this because this is something that God put in my heart. What are we not accomplishing because we're not praying with confidence or power? What is our church not experiencing because we're not willing to pray with confidence and boldness? I wonder, what could we accomplish if we truly believe in prayer and the power of prayer? What does God want to accomplish in us? Where could God take you? What if he potentially is going to take you around the world? What if he wants to take you somewhere else? When God begins to lead, he begins to call us out. And what if he's calling us out? What if it's a place like Haiti? So this morning, as we end our message this morning, and we talk about this sent life, I'm going to invite Dan Coughlin to come. And he's going to share about his experience of this connection between what does it mean to be sent? What does that look like in our lives?
Great. Thank you, Pastor. As many of you know and have asked me about, I recently returned from a trip to Haiti and experienced the power of prayer in ways that I've never seen, and my world has been absolutely rocked, and I'll never be the same. So running through quickly, here's kind of a map of Haiti. If you go to the next one, please. So we arrive, pack up the luggage on the top. Here's Malcolm at the beginning. You see kind of the mountains in the back. And we leave the airport, entering in Port-au-Prince, the capital of Haiti. And it's a city probably like you might imagine as we're leaving the airport. But pretty quickly, that turned into this. And there's a lot of this. The poverty in Haiti is nothing like I've ever seen. And I've seen a lot of poor places. But 80% of the people in Haiti live on $2 a day or less. So kind of picture what that might mean. Next, please. When you travel around in Haiti, this is the primary way of travel. They're called tap-taps, these old pickup trucks with kind of metal structures over the top. Pastor, this probably looks familiar. Pastor's been there to Haiti and traveled in these. Right? If you go to the next one, there's a little bit closer look of the bed. So there's some sort of a metal structure that they kind of fashion on top. Benches along the side, and there's a close-up of the bench. The seats aren't really that well padded, so this is the primary way that we kind of got around from place to place to place within Haiti. Next one. So we started making the rounds a little bit. So here's, kind of get off the main road, and we're walking up. And so a lot of the ministry that's really prayer-driven here. First, we'll look at some of the things like Bible studies. So these go on all the time. Malcolm does about 11 of these a week. So here's one. People gather from all over the place, and not many people have chairs. The kids that are sitting on a bench there is actually, they turned it sideways and are sitting on the little one just to try and get enough seating for people. Next one. So then we came down. After that one that was up the mountain, we came down. We were in the city. You kind of wind your way through these little passageways. And let me camp here for a minute. This photo I took with a panoramic view camera, so it's a little deceptive. This room looks bigger here in the photo than it really was. The actual size of this room was probably about the size of this platform up here, this narrow piece kind of between the stools. And in there were 40 people, most of whom had been waiting about an hour for us to arrive. It's about 90 degrees. There's no breeze or ventilation through there because it's all just packed in. And everybody's here sitting on the ground or standing waiting to hear God's word. Next one, please. So now we go away from those. Now we're going to go into the actual worship services. Here's the first church that that they built. So if we go inside, and this one is the widow's meeting. So they have a widow's worship service once a month, and everybody comes in, and the praise here, these people are very, very poor, but they get dressed up in their Sunday best. You can see the women have their hats on, and you know, they're singing. You can see hands in the air, just this exuberant praise, which was just inspiring in and of itself. And then they were talking about, hey, this joy that you feel inside, we've got to make sure that this can get to your friends and your neighbors and your family. So we need to pray for our friends and neighbors and family to be reached. So this group of widows got down on their knees and prayed on the concrete floor for a long time, out loud. So exactly the way the pastor was just talking about this concert of prayer, I was just going to say I got choked up. Just being in this room and seeing this, kind of like I'm feeling right now. And this prayer was just amazing. So now if we go to the next one. So now we're going to switch to the other side. So that was the widows, the older folks. So now we have one with kids. They pulled together four of the children's groups from four of the churches all into this one session. So they pull them all into this room. It was about 300 kids that all got pulled into here for these worship services. And they had them together in little groups. Each group then would go and they would present their memory verses. They would sing a song, maybe do a dance, right? Next one. Sound familiar? So they've got all the kids gathered, and pause on this one a second. They have all the kids gathered, and kind of between sessions, all of a sudden this song breaks out. I cannot understand a word of it, obviously. It's in Creole, which is their native language. But I still start hearing 300 kids singing How Great Thou Art. I got choked up again. I cried a lot. I got choked up a lot there. Yeah, just amazing. So now, so this place is packed, 300 kids. If you look closely, there's not enough chairs for everybody. So along this one, I took a picture of this one along the back. You've got 10 kids sitting on two chairs and a board. Right, next one. Yeah, let's look at that one for a minute. That's the boards. So I know our pews aren't perfect. Do they feel a little bit better right now? Next one, please. So after the worship services, then we go on the prayer-driven kind of evangelism visits to voodoo camps. All right, next one. So we come to this house. There's a woman you can see perhaps a little bit in the foreground. Her name is Carol. She is a voodoo priestess that has just accepted Christ. So they come in and they're going to talk to Carol. Yeah, and it gets even more incredible than this, and I'll keep building. So they talk to Carol. I want to understand you want to accept Christ. Yes, they kind of lead her through exactly what that means. Now she's going to go and say, all right, I'm going to burn my voodoo stuff. So they bring it outside and take her stuff, and they go and they burn all of her voodoo things there. So there's like the capes, the dresses, the powders, the oils, all the stuff that people use for voodoo. Right, Carol's stuff now is all in that thing. So she's denounced voodoo and burned her stuff, so there's no going back. Right, next one. So now there's another voodoo camp that we're going to go to, and this one's up the mountain. It's not in the city. So we go up kind of this little trail, get up to the mountain. Next one, please. Next one, there's a voodoo priest, guy in the middle with the vertical striped shirt. He, too, is ready to denounce voodoo and accept Christ. So next one. So he, too, brings out all of his stuff. The powders, the oils, the robe, the pictures, the icons, the symbols. It all comes out in a pile. Next one. And he proceeds to go and burn that. So now I'm standing there and I'm like, I just left someplace where I was in basically a place where they hold voodoo ceremonies, and now that's getting burned. And now I'm up in this. This is a camp. This is the stuff where they would do the pole, the sacrificing animals, all of it, all that stuff you picture from voodoo. We went and learned a lot about this and met a lot of the people. That's what really happens. And that's right there. So I'm like, I'm physically in this place, and I've just seen two people that are not just individuals, but practitioners. Right, next one. And I was carrying around a journal with me, and I had this bulletin in there, and I pulled out my bulletin, and I'm like, this is what scent looks like. And realize I'm freaking out a little bit, right? This is like real voodoo stuff. I'm in the camp, and it was just surreal. Next one. So the following day, there were going to be some baptisms. One of the people showed up and said, hey, Malcolm, I've accepted, but I didn't burn all my voodoo stuff. There was something else that I was still holding back. Here, I'm going to get baptized. I want you to burn this too. So we did that before the ceremony. Next one, please. So here's some photos from the baptism ceremony, and I'll kind of camp on this for a minute and point out a couple things. First of all, look at everybody dressed in these white clothes that they come to go and get baptized in the Caribbean Sea. First of all, I'm not sure how people get clothes this white or how they keep them this white, because a lot of these people live in huts with dirt floors. So we kind of figure that out. Second of all, what you may be able to make out in the upper left is the group was gathered around in a circle and they were singing. They have somebody that has like a hymn book, and they're singing, and this group proceeded to keep singing for the entire time, both before and throughout all the baptisms, for like an hour and a half. The whole group just kept praising and singing, you know, a cappella. Next one. So the way that this was set up, and you may be able to make out, is out in the water there, there's kind of two separate pairs of pastors that were actually doing the baptisms. So the way that they set up is the group would be here on the shore, they would walk a person out to each of the groups, they would do a baptism, and then I'm kind of in the foreground here with my Core Alpha Omega shirt. And then one of us would go in, you know, as the person was coming in, take a towel, bring it out to them, and pray with the person. So we were instructed, go out, meet them as they're coming back, and pray with them. I wasn't sure why praying with them was such a specific objective or directive, but I found out quickly. In advance of this baptism, Malcolm had kind of told us, hey, look, in a group this size, you're probably going to see some demon manifestation. And I wasn't sure what that meant, and the baptism ceremony started, and I didn't see it at the beginning, but pretty shortly, I did. So we were about 10 or 15 minutes into it, and there was a woman that had just gotten baptized out there in the back to the right with that group of pastors, and she comes up out of the water, and her body starts going into a convulsion. Her arms go up in the air. She's waving them back and forth. She's shrieking. Arms still continue waving. And the pastors have seen this before, so they turn toward the shore to the group of us and started waving people out. So we get up to her, and she's convulsing. Her eyes are rolled back in her head. Her head is thrown back, and she's growling. Once again, pretty intense. Dan hasn't seen this before in Naperville, USA. However, they were prepared for this. So they waved people out, and they were waving people out to come and gather around her and pray on her. We surrounded this woman. Everybody laid hands on her and prayed together out loud in the name of Jesus, repeating that over and over, and everybody praying out loud specifically invoking Jesus' name for power here. It's the Holy Spirit that has power over this woman. The demons no longer have any right to her. And after what seemed like an eternity, which was probably about a minute or 90 seconds, her body relaxed and her eyes rolled back down forward, and she started looking around like, what just happened? The power of prayer. Next one, please. So through the power of prayer, here are some of the things that have been accomplished since Malcolm and Joy have gotten down there. First of all, there's food distributions to thousands of people. They're doing medical treatments from baby deliveries to surgeries. There's mission trips, both standard kind of every other month and then almost every quarter kind of medical trips. There's clothing being delivered. There's ministries to widows, orphans, the blind on a monthly basis. They have schools set up. They're sponsoring people for education. There's assignment with prayer families for families back and forth praying with one another. Homes are being rebuilt. There's apprenticeships that they have set up in different trades to try and get people empowered to go and fund themselves. But the real power through prayer here are the things that are highlighted in red, the salvations. So that couple voodoo priests that I was talking about are two of scores and hundreds of people that have come out of voodoo. There are now 11 churches since they're down there in 7 years of between 60 and 300 people each. So you do a little bit of math, we're talking about probably 1,100 to 1,500 people, most of whom have come out of voodoo, many of whom were actually voodoo priests and priestesses. And what's really cool is that a lot of this is through Haitian pastors and evangelists. That group of people getting baptized that I had just shown, it was 34 people. 2 months before that date was set, that was an intended date for baptisms. So 2 months earlier, when Malcolm and Joy had returned to the U.S. to come back for their daughter's wedding, they had a group of four people that were queued up to be baptized. They got back, and it was a group of 34. That means 30 of the 34 were reached not by Americans, but by Haitians, especially two people. And if you keep these women's names, I'd really encourage you or request that you keep them in prayer. One's named Ketley, and one is named Deba, former voodoo priestesses that are unbelievable anointed evangelists for Jesus Christ, but also are facing tremendous spiritual attacks. So if you could keep praying for them. So there's people, so it's really disciples making disciples. Next. So if you go to the next slide. All right, so there's some things that are happening in Haiti in a long time ago on a land far, far away, but what does this really mean to me? Next one, please. So pray. Pray for Malcolm, Joy, these practitioners, the people of Haiti. Pray up and down the Fox Valley. Next, please. So this should look familiar. Here's our mission. We, that God is calling us to, Trinity, pray deeper, reach wider. The power of this prayer is just absolutely astounding. Next, please. There's a lot of opportunities to pray in addition for those specific intents. So on Sunday mornings, there's prayer practicum. On Tuesday morning at 6:30, there's a men's prayer meeting. On Wednesday evenings, there's group prayer that's now kind of traveling down these different locations. So it's gone through St. Charles, Geneva, Batavia. As Pastor had mentioned, this week is scheduled to be North Aurora. Next one, please. So if you look, so here's from 2 weeks ago. This is the one that was in Geneva, right? We've got a small group here. We have an exuberant Parker in the front, and I love this picture. If you can see Joe in the back, I'm not sure if you can see this, but like he's very wide-eyed. I love it. So that's 2 weeks ago in Geneva. Next one, please. Here's this week. Look at the size of the group here. So this is this week in Batavia. So what could it look like in North Aurora? What if we had this whole group praying together in North Aurora as we go up and down the Fox Valley and just having God show us, God, what would you have us do? Next one, please. So, the opportunities that we have moving forward, certainly all of these prayer intents, the class that I had mentioned last week, my role, his mission. Does everybody know what your calling is? Does anybody might have your talent that's still buried underground? So this class that starts next week really is designed to do two things. First of all, help you identify your calling. And then secondly, even if you know what it is but not sure what to do with it, to go ahead and help you identify specific steps of what can I do with the talent that God has given me. Next one. So if we do those things, pray, realize what our calling is, our talent is, and do something with it, and as we work through this study of the book of Acts, read that chapter every week. Be in God's word every week. Just think what sent could look like for you or for us as a church.
It's amazing. We want to have more sent stories. We want to have more stories of how God is leading you and he is calling you to places that you wouldn't necessarily anticipate going. But it's because of God and through the Holy Spirit that you're being led there. So would you stand with me as we close our service this morning? I'm thankful to be a part of a faith community that believes in the power of prayer. I'm thankful to be a part of a church that recognizes that when we pray, things happen. I'm thankful to testify to you the other testimonies of people that have called in the middle of the night for prayer and the miraculous things that God has done through this faith community, through this church, because of the belief in the power of prayer. This morning is an opportunity, I pray, to encourage you to continue to pray, to keep sharpening that stone of prayer in your spiritual quiver, to keep remembering that God will do bold things when we pray boldly, that we don't need to question his unquestionable power. He is for us, not against us. He is with us, and we just need to keep taking him up on that. Amen? And so now as we conclude our service, I just encourage you to hold your hands open to receive this blessing, this benediction over you. And it'll be up on the screens, and I encourage you as you know it or just to receive it. Sometimes it's good for us not to say the blessing. It's just to receive it this week, so maybe that's you. I just want to pray this blessing and this benediction over you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen and amen. You are sent.